Thank you, Bill. Well, good morning and welcome to worship as Second Baptist Church. I'm so glad you chose to join us either in this space or if you're worshiping from home, we're glad that you've chosen to join us as well. You can let us know that you're joining us officially if you're worshiping from home by liking us on the YouTube channel or liking or loving on the Facebook page or leaving a comment on Facebook, and we would love to see that you're here. Or if you're here in this space with us right now, you can let us know you're here by taking your phone and scanning the QR code or by texting H-E-L-L-O to 816-355-4736. Don't forget the O. I'm not sure what happens if you forget the O, but I don't think you want to find out. If you're a guest here with us, we're also especially glad that you're here and that you've chosen to join us in worship this week, and we'd love to get to know you better. And one of the ways that we can get to know you better is I'm hosting a Coffee with the Pastor next Sunday at 10 o'clock in the Oak Room. Would love for you to join me for that, and that's a time for us to get to know one another better and answer questions about the church and just connect in that way. You can register for that on the website or by calling the church office this week, and we'd love to spend that time together getting to know one another. And that's not the only reason to come next week. Next week, September 12th, we will have a Sunday fun day, right, Kim? A Sunday fun day. And there's going to be lots of fun things to engage in after the service together. We're going to have food trucks. We're going to have games. There's going to be space to hang out and catch up and opportunities to learn about how you can connect and invest in the life of Second Baptist Church in the coming months as well. This is our fall kickoff Sunday. And as a part of that fall kickoff, we'll kick off a worship series that is simply titled Renew. And I will be preaching on ways that we can pursue and posture ourselves for renewal. And we'll be doing that throughout the fall. So I hope you'll come and be with us next week as we begin that series. Emmett's actually sort of previewing one of the sermons in that series. We didn't plan that together, but there's going to be some overlap in the sermon that he's preaching later today in this service. And there are also some great groups starting next week and the week after that. Connie's going to be teaching through Adam Hamilton's book, The Walk, which is really about discipleship and taking next steps in faith. So if that's something that's interesting to you, maybe you'll join in with that group. And then the week after that, on September 19th, Dr. Hewlett Glower is starting a series on James, and that's going to be incredible. So I hope you'll look at both of those. You can register online for those or call the church office as well. We've got lots of great stuff coming up. Haiti Day on September 18th at the park. We need clothes for the Clay County Clothes Closet. You can find out about these things by looking on our website or looking in the monthly as well. There's lots of things you can find out about that are going on in the life of the church, or like us on Facebook. We do, one more thing I want to mention, we need childcare workers. We cannot do the things that we want to do right now as a church, all the things, without your help. We need to come together and do these things, all the things together as a church body. And we want to do all the things we can do for our children, and for that to happen, we need your help. And one of the ways we need your help right now is with worship childcare volunteers. So Angie Fuller's back there in the back. She can raise her hand. You know who she is. Let Angie know if you're willing to serve at all in worship childcare or with our children in other ways. And you know what else we need? We need rest. It seems ironic in the midst of all I'm sharing and asking of you right now. We need Sabbath. We need God to minister to us in the midst of our weariness. We need renewal. In the words of Psalm 42, as the deer pants for the water, we are longing. We are longing for God and for God's renewal, the renewal that only God can bring into our life. So I hope and I pray that today is renewing for you. That in the midst of this Sabbath, you find Sabbath. And that in the midst of this service, you experience the deep renewing connection that can only come through a relationship with the living God and through connecting with the living God in worship, as we worship God in spirit and in truth. We do that now. We worship the living God together. Thank you.
Good morning. Please join me in our responsive reading today. I will read the light print and ask that you join me in the dark print. There is none like you among the gods, O Lord, nor are there any works like yours. For you are great and do wondrous things. You alone are God. Teach me your way, O Lord, that I may walk in your truth. Give me an undivided heart to revere your name. O Lord, you are our Father. We are the clay, and you are our potter. We are all the work of your hand. I appeal to you, therefore, brothers and sisters, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Then Jesus said to them all, if any want to become my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross daily and follow me.
Good, all your ways are sure. I will trust in you alone, higher than my sight, high above my life. I will trust in you alone, in you alone. Where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow you. Whom you love, I love. How you serve, I'll serve. In this life I lose, I will follow you. Yeah, I will follow you. Light into the world, light into my life. I will live for you alone. You're the one I see, no one I will. All I need in you alone, where you go, where you stay, when you move, I'll move, I will follow you, whom you love, I'll love, how you serve, I'll serve, if this life I lose, I will follow you. I will follow you. In you there's life everlasting. In you there's freedom for my soul. In you there's joy, unending joy. And I will follow. Where you go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move, I will follow you. Whom you love. How you serve, I'll serve. If this life I lose, I will follow. Where you go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move, I will follow you. Whom you love. How you serve, I'll serve. If this life I lose, I will follow you. I will follow you. I will follow you. I will follow you.
Pray with me. Holy God, we are so grateful that you are here with us and that you are also always with us as we go and serve and love and live in your name, in your world. And may this time of worship prompt us to better shine your light in this world as we live into the work of offering your love to this world, both near and far. God, this morning we're mindful of loved ones and others, some who are suffering and others who have died from COVID-19. And we're mindful of those who are grieving for them. We're mindful also of our first responders and healthcare professionals who are treating so many patients right now. We're mindful that our hospitals are at or nearing capacity right now. We're mindful of worried parents and educators and so many others of us, all of us, who are just feeling whipped and weighed down by this pandemic and who are asking for you to bring all of these pandemic labors to an end. Because God, we are weary from this and from other forms of struggle and strife we've experienced this past week as well. As a church, we're praying specifically for Carol, Kathy, Vicky, Thomas, Elaine, Edith, Terry, Keith, Brooke, Ayup, William, Felicia, Colette, Dolores, Cindy, Rachel, Mike, Diane, Amber, Carolyn, Richard, Joshua, Caleb, Karen, Janet, Mary Lou, Les, Ted, Butch, Linda, Dan, and others who are on our hearts and minds right now. We also ask that you would comfort Heather Schumacher as she grieves the death of her uncle Rick. God, many of us are also mindful right now of those suffering in the aftermath of Hurricane Ida and those impacted by the earthquake in Haiti before that. We're asking for your love and care to be known in every way that's needed to those who are picking up the pieces of their lives right now. We're mindful of loved ones who are suffering through the smoke and fires out west, and who are asking for relief. We're also mindful of those in our country who are suffering in the wake of gun violence this past week. And in the midst of all of our weariness, of all of this, we're also mindful of the families of U.S. service members and Afghani civilians who are grieving the loss of loved ones from the attack in Kabul and from the rise of the Taliban to power in Afghanistan. And the fear and the oppression that so many are living with there and throughout that region. Oh God, God, we think of them and all who are grieving. In response to the events of the past week or two, and also as we approach the 20th anniversary of September 11th, 2001. God, we pray for your presence and mercy and miracles of grace and compassion to be known in all of their lives. And on this weekend, when we look toward a Labor Day given, which was really given to us as a day of rest from our labor, we pray that they and so many others who are suffering around our world would experience deep, holy, and healing rest. For it's in the name of Christ, our Prince of Peace, that we pray. Amen.
Guide my feet while I run this race.
Yes, my Lord.
Guide my feet while I run this race.
Yes, my Lord.
Guide my feet while I run this race. For I don't want to run this race in vain.
Stand by me while I run this race.
Yes, my Lord,
stand by me while I run this race.
Yes, my Lord,
stand by me while I run this race. For I don't want to run this race in vain. Search my heart while I run this race.
Yes, my Lord.
Search my heart while I run this race.
Yes, my Lord.
Search my heart while I run this race. For I don't want to run this race in vain.
Today's passage could be familiar to you, one that might be considered a simple story about Jesus' visit to the home of his good friends Martha and Mary. But let us all listen with fresh ears today to the scripture and to Emmitt's teaching and be open to hear something new that God might want us to learn in this season of our lives. If you are able, I invite you to stand for the reading of God's word. From the Gospel of Luke, chapter 10, verses 38 through 42. Now as they went on their way, he entered a certain village where a woman named Martha welcomed him into her home. She had a sister named Mary who sat at the Lord's feet and listened to what he was saying. But Martha was distracted by her many tasks, so she came to him and asked, "Lord, do you not care that my sister has left me to do all the work by myself? Tell her then to help me." But the Lord answered her, "Martha, Martha, you are worried and distracted by many things. There is need of only one thing. Mary has chosen the better part, which will not be taken away from her." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Duncan wrote the red crayon to the owner out of the crayon box. "Duncan, we need to talk. All year long, I wear myself out coloring fire engines, apples, strawberries, and everything else that's red. I even work on holidays. I color all the Santas at Christmas and all the hearts on Valentine's Day. I need a rest." Signed, your overworked friend, Red Crayon. These are the opening pages of a cute children's book named The Day the Crayons Quit. Red Crayon had had enough of overworking and was longing for some sort of rest from, you know, the busy life that Red Crayons have. And not just Red Crayon, gray Crayon as well. After all, coloring large elephants and rhinos and hippos and humpback whales, they're all big animals. And that left Gray longing for lighter days where Gray could just color a small pebble or two. And then there was Blue Crayon, who enjoyed coloring the occasional ocean and lake and river, but has worked so much that Blue could no longer see over the edge of the crayon box. And so Blue and Red and Gray Crayons asked Duncan, the owner, for a break. In the book, there are other crayons there, and they have their own concerns. Some of them were concerned about not coloring enough, and some of them wanted to be more creative. But of all the concerns that were there in the book, the one that was most prevalent and came up the most were the crayons that were overworked. And I suspect that crayons aren't the only ones that are susceptible to being out of balance with work and rest. You and I may actually be more like red and blue and gray crayon than we realize. Overworked, underrested, and longing for some degree of emotional, physical, and spiritual rest in our lives, and longing for a rhythm of life that is sustainable for our health and our well-being. We see it in cute books about crayons, and we see it in our own lives and in the lives of the ones we love. And we see it in this short passage in Luke chapter 10. In our passage today, we see two sisters, Mary, and we see Martha, with two different rhythms of life. One's rhythm consists of frantic working, and the other taking a rest at the feet of Jesus. Martha is over encumbered. She's distracted and frustrated in her working and in her serving and in her preparing in order to make sure that everybody else and everything else is taken care of. She's doing good things, y'all. Most likely, she's cooking for others, making sure that the plates are filled and to make sure that the cups are full. She's preparing for Jesus and for those who are accompanying him. She's doing all the things. But her sister, Mary, appears to be doing nothing. This is no sibling rivalry here. It's not about whose turn it is to do dishes or to clear the table. It's much more simple than that. And it is also much more important. This is about work and about rest, about service and about Sabbath, about outward living and also inner rest and healing. And Luke's gospel records this small but significant household tension between two sisters to highlight the tension we often have between service and Sabbath. The great commandments, as revealed by Jesus, are twofold. The first is to love the Lord our God with all of our being, that's heart, soul, mind, and strength. And the second is to love our neighbor as ourselves. Summed up with those two are the summation of the biblical law. The concept is simple. Our faith has two foci, each informing the other. Loving God, which informs how we love our neighbor, and loving our neighbor, which affirms our love for God. The concept is simple, but it's like the tagline of the board game Othello. It takes a minute to learn, but a lifetime to master. And that is because for most of us, we struggle to do both well. We tend to favor one at the expense of the other. This has much to do with our cultural values that value excessive work, which tells us that we will be rewarded with a happy life as long as we do as Martha does. That is, work, 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 and work. Dean Schaubner of ABC News writes an article just a few years ago about the busyness of our lives. He said this: not only are Americans working longer hours than at any time since statistics have been kept. But we are also working longer hours than any of the other industrialized world. And while workers in other countries have been seeing hours cut back in order to prevent it from infringing on private life, Americans have been going in the other direction. The cultural trend is to immerse ourselves in the daily grind, the extra hours, the nonstop weeks that flow into nonstop weekends in hopes that we will have a happy life. Excessive work, the daily grind, the status quo of our culture. But that is not the way of Jesus. And it is not the way that God intended. From the beginning, God has modeled for us a rhythm of life. The creation of the world in Genesis through work and rest. Out of the void, God commanded the light and separates it from the darkness. God brings to order the oceans and God structures the sky. God hangs the moon and the stars and the sky. God hangs the sun. God establishes and fashions the creatures and forms humanity. And God says, it is good, it is good, it is good, it is good, it is very good. And on the seventh day, God rested from the work. God rests with creation, where creator and created are present together in beauty and holiness. In the book Sabbath by Wayne Miller, he shares that the ancient rabbis used to teach that on the seventh day, God did create something. They said that the rabbinic tradition says that God created serenity, peace, and repose. Rest in the deepest possible sense of healing and stillness. And in that tradition, they says, until the Sabbath, creation was unfinished. And only after the birth of this tranquility, this rest, was the circle of creation made full and complete. I wonder how many of us may struggle with having that feeling of fullness and completeness because of the struggle that we have finding the rest that we so desperately need in God. Rest, Sabbath, stillness, they are as much of the work of creation as the formation of the universe, and they are as much of the work of the faith-filled life as the embodied gospel, as the work of proclaiming and of loving and of serving. The Sabbath rest, holy stillness, it's not a provision that should be just tacked on at the end of a work day or at the end of a work week only after we have completed absolutely everything that we can think about or complete. Because the truth of the matter is, we will always be able to think of something else. There's always one last thing to remember. Even when we're in the bed trying to lay ourselves down, there's one more thing that tends to pop up in our minds. But the Sabbath rest as a model, one of which Jesus follows, and the rhythm of life that God offers us is one in which we learn to stop and embrace and take that rest with God so that we can be renewed. It's for our good. It's for our well-being. It's for you. It's for me. And that work-rest rhythm that we are called to by Jesus, Jesus says it's the good part. Imagine life that consisted of work alone, without Sabbath and holy rest. It is like trying to breathe by inhaling and never taking a stop to exhale. Sure, you may be able to function for a short while just on the inhale, but sooner or later, in order to live, you have to exhale. Because the inhale and the exhale in rhythm are needed if you are going to breathe as God intended. We were created to work, and we were created to rest. Work and rest in a rhythm that invites us into the joy and fruitfulness of work, and also the joy of resting our minds, our hearts, our body, and our soul in the renewing presence of God. And without an established rhythm, sooner or later, we will find ourselves out of breath. Martha was out of breath. Her serving and cooking was out of sync with what Jesus was doing. And so was she, because her good work was coupled with frustrations that she held with Mary, who knew how to rest in the presence of Jesus. Yes, the dishes were important, but only one thing in that moment was necessary for her well-being. Only one thing was needed. And without the rhythm, Martha is standing with full hands, but a weary and frustrated heart. We even see Martha's frustration starting to spill out. She's even telling Jesus what he ought to do. Both are doing important things, but only Mary had found a work-life rhythm that was sustainable for her whole being. And she will not allow anything to keep her from it. Now, we all have things that we contend with that desync us out of a healthy rhythm of work and rest, of service and Sabbath. For me, I contend with the tendency to want to place my own needs of rest with God on the back burner for the care of others. And I sometimes do that because I think inwardly I don't really want to deal with the conflict that arises from asserting my own needs. But that's just me. What do you contend with? The thing is, we all have our own things that we contend with for these healthy rhythms of life by which we are called to. The things that keep us out of sync with the rhythm of work and rest, service and Sabbath. But there's good news this morning. And that good news, the gospel, is that we don't have to stay out of sync. That no matter how long we have been stuck in unhealthy ruts and rhythms, no matter how long we have been out of rhythm or out of sync or out of breath, no matter how long we have neglected creating times and spaces to be with God, God is always inviting us into God's rhythm. God is always granting us the opportunity to change our rhythm and to get in sync with the rhythm that produces life in us. Just as the rhythm of day and night continues so that each are anew, so are the graces and mercies of God, so are the opportunities to reset our lives, to prioritize times of rest with our Creator. New day, new mercies, new grace, new rhythms. And you can make it, starting even now. And so what changes do you need to make to prioritize your rhythm with God? As was mentioned earlier, in worship, later this fall, we will return to this concept. It's that important. And we will return in our upcoming sermon series on renewal. But you don't have to wait until then.
to make the change. You can start right now by considering your own current rhythm and identifying where you would like to make a change. And then perhaps, maybe, even with a little humor, we can be like red crayon and gray and blue to shout out our needs and tend to them by resting in the life-giving presence of God.
As I sing this familiar hymn, let me invite you to look at the words in your worship guide and use this as a time of meditation. Take my life and let it be consecrated, Lord, to Thee. Take my moments and my days, let them flow in ceaseless praise. Let them flow in ceaseless praise. Take my hands and let them move at the impulse of Thy love. Take my feet and let them be swift and beautiful for Thee, swift and beautiful for Thee. Take my voice and let me sing always only for my King. Take my lips and let them be filled with messages from Thee, filled with messages from Thee. Take my will and make it Thine. It shall no longer be mine. Take my heart, it is Thine own. It shall be Thy royal throne. It shall be Thy royal throne.
I hope that you find today to be a day of which life-giving rest found in God finds you wherever you are. And so I ask that you stand with me as I share this benediction with you this morning. May the one who seeks you find you when you fall. May the one who loves you take delight in your living. May the one who send you now in joy. For in your gladness and in your grieving, in your brokenness and in your healing, in your faithfulness and in your leaving, the one who made you and redeemed you is the one who keeps you still.